We must stop the terror. I call upon all nations to do everything they can to stop these terrorist killers.
Thank you.
Now watch this drive.
I mean, if you're a Scientologist, you see life, but you see things the way they are. In all its glory, you know, all of its complexity.
Hi everybody, it's me again. Just catching up on my Scientology news, which, believe it or not, despite my three videos, I received this in the mail about, I don't know, 5-6 days ago, so it shows you where the cult's intelligence is at right now, is that no one's figured out who I am, even though I use my correct first name, is posted with the video, and it's at least 700-800 Sea Org members know my face, know who I am. So they're still sending me stuff. I also got another video as well. Thanks, guys. I'm probably not going to need it. And that guy who sent that email for me to join the Sea Org might not be happening. I don't know, but just you know, it might not happen. But anyways, the reason I brought this up, I actually brought this to the camera, is we got here Worldwide Dianetics. This is too recent. This is like 1 week old. And what it is this big... they call it Dianetics Bookathon, and what they're trying to do is, of course, sell a whole bunch of books. Now, the question I have about this is, in the 70s, there's what came out is called New Era Dianetics, and abbreviated NED, you know, NED, New Era Dianetics, and what that was a vast improvement over what's called Book One Dianetics, which is Dianetics, Modern Science and Mental Health, which is this book that they're selling 2 weeks ago. Now, tell me one thing, on the back of the New Era Dianetics pack, it says this technology is 100 times faster and more efficient and better technology than Book One. So tell me, Scientologist, and Terrio, my favorite commenter, why is it that we're still pushing a book from the 1950s like crazy when it was said by L. Ron Hubbard himself that it's 100 times better, this New Era Dianetics technology? Why continue to push the old, old technology? You know, I'm not making this up, you know, they're still pushing this. This was footage from an event that was maybe a month or two ago. Why are we continuing to push this book? You know, I know it's all the basic principles are in there. Yeah, well, you can learn that from the New Era Dianetics pack, too. I mean, why are we pushing the old technology? You know. Okay, I just wanted to talk about a few other things. Another thing is the term WOG. I know you guys have heard WOG, and you know Mark Bunker calls his site the WOG blog, and you may think, well, what the hell does WOG mean? Okay, well, what WOG means, it's basically the derogatory term for anyone who's not a Scientologist and not, you know, a cult member. And I do mean derogatory, because we used to, when I was in the Sea Org and we were talking amongst ourselves, we'd get someone come in from the ship, you know, from like Barbados, Bahamas or something, and he'd come on the ship, and you know, we'd all go, oh, keep your voices down, they're WOGs, you know, they're, you know, like they were aliens or something, or they were from Mars or something. I mean, it was really weird, you know. And you get kind of, and you'd also have this thing of well, they're lesser than us, or they're beneath us, you know. So you get this whole arrogant thing, which you've probably seen some of these guys come out, and they talk like they're better than us. That's one of the reasons why. And also, if you look at any just general cult literature, like on what a cult is and the different parts of a cult, you'll see that it talks a lot about creating an us and them mentality. Like there's us, you know, the Scientologists, and then there's them. And one of the ways is to have a derogatory term for the other guys, you know. Like they're, like the Nazis obviously had, you know, they're the Jews, you know. And here we go, well, they're the WOGs. Which is kind of funny, considering they're always talking about how they're all denominational and welcome to everyone. They always welcome, and then they walk out and go, oh, they were just a bunch of WOGs, you know. And just as a little side note, if you want to really have a good laugh, get the technical dictionary, the Burgundy one that was around for 20, 30 years, and look up WOG in the dictionary, and look at what WOG stands for. And I'm not making this up. You guys can verify this if you want. I know it sounds ludicrous, but what it actually stands for is Worthy Oriental Gentleman. Now, if you can figure that one out, let me know. And Terrio, please give me your explanation on that one, because I'm confused. 10 years, I can't figure that one out. Worthy Oriental Gentleman, what Orientals have to do with it? I thought you guys were all, you know, denominational, you know, all welcome to everybody. Except Worthy Oriental Gentlemen, I guess. I don't know. Okay, as a continuing theme, I always talk about the Rehabilitation Project Force, the RPF, the prison camp, just because it's such a popular subject, and you really can't argue with the RPF. So, and I have another very more specific story, just so the Scientologists can't say, oh, he's using generalities and all this kind of stuff. Okay, well, I'll give you an exact person, okay? In January of 96, okay, there was a guy on the ship, on the Freewinds, and his name was Flavio Pernanelli, I can't pronounce it, it's an Italian name, he was Italian, Pernanelli or something like that. He was on the ship, he was a course supervisor, his mother was also a Sea Org member, her name was Brunella. Now, this guy was put under what's called a Committee of Evidence, which is the Scientology Justice Action, and he was presided over and the whole deal. And he was put on the RPF for, get this, being a homosexual. Okay? That was it. He did nothing else. He didn't steal any money. He didn't hurt anybody. He didn't do anything. He was just a homosexual. Okay? And he was basically put on the slave camp. This was in the mid-90s. And when I left in 2004, he was still there. Okay? I never saw him come off. I don't know where he is. I heard that he was still there shortly before I left, so I do know he was there. And he was there getting, you know, obviously doing the hard labor and the bad hours and the bad food, you know, all the typical stuff. But he was there getting processing to cure his homosexuality. I don't know. That doesn't seem right to me. I'm not gay myself, so I can't really say, but you know, as far as I know, homosexuality is not cured, even though Scientologists definitely believe that it's an illness, it's a sickness, it's in Science of Survival. If you guys want proof, pick up Science of Survival. It should still be available to everyone. And look up the tone level of 1.1. He talks all about homosexuality and about how it's this horrible mental illness, and it's this, just, he talks so horribly, and they're these horrible pervers, and they're these horrible, you know. I mean, okay, you guys are all denominational, and you're all, you know, supporting everyone, and you're everyone's welcome. Well, yeah, except a huge part of the culture, yeah. Another thing that you guys should be aware of, non-Scientologists, is the whole thing with blowing and being declared. In Scientology, the word blow, or to blow, or blowing, basically means to leave suddenly without telling anyone, without saying anything. You just leave. That's it. That's all it means. So when you blow a Scientology organization, that would mean you just basically pick up your bags and you leave and you don't answer your phone, you know, whatever. Okay? No big deal, right? Okay, well, there's a big reference, and it's applied all the time, that if you blow a Scientology organization of any kind at any time, you're immediately issued a declare order, which means you're declared a suppressive person. And L. Ron Hubbard describes a suppressive person. He compares it to Hitler, Napoleon, serial killers. That, like, he actually uses Ted Bundy as an example, who is a guy who killed people and, you know, buried them in his backyard and all this stuff. So basically, if you leave a church, you just leave, you're basically up there with serial killers and Hitler, basically. So that seems like a little harsh to me, I don't know. I think it's just a way of protecting the church and, making sure that anyone, you know, it dissuades people from leaving, you know, if they want to leave and then, oh no, I'll be declared if I leave, so I'll stay. And it keeps them there. It keeps them, through fear tactics, it keeps them there. And on that same note, another thing you should realize that Scientologists do is they keep what's called ethics files. And what they do is they keep... Basically, when you're a public, you're a customer, you're a staff member, whatever, and you do anything, they encourage you to write reports on everything, like, blah, stuck gum under the table, he swore at blah blah, you know, anything. You write a report and it goes into your ethics folder that has your name on it. Now that's kept for years and years and years. Now, for example, me, I was in for 10 years. You can imagine I have quite a few ethics folders. Well, those are permanent records and they can use those against you. And what you got to realize is if you do any reading about the Nazis used to have a system like that where they would keep files of people, of files of things they've done or things that people they've been with or anything that's going on. And then as soon as they have problems with that person, they basically dig up that file and they root through it. And I used to work in Department 3, which is the department that used to do the ethics files. And we used to do summaries of it, and we used to use that information. And when there was a problem with someone, we'd have all this information, and we'd just pile up all this information, and we would attack them with it, or we'd put them in ethics, you know, which means, you know, they have to do formulas and they have to do hard labor and all this stuff. And this isn't even RPF. This is like just for minor stuff. And just realize that this is a system that they use. And the other thing you also got to realize too, one other book you should maybe look at is if you can go into an organization and pick up Hymn of Asia, okay? It was a book they've had out for about 30 years. It should be available to everyone, okay? It's called the Hymn of Asia. It's basically like a poem. It's like a 300-page poem, sort of a verse kind of thing. Like, it's not really a poem, but it's kind of like a, it's something like a poem. And it's a good 300-400 pages long. And it's written by L. Ron Hubbard. It has his name clearly on it. And I'm not making this up. You can go read it, go get yourself your hands on it, because it basically says that L. Ron Hubbard is Buddha. And he came back from 3,000 years ago, and here he is starting his movement again. You know, he had, you know, Buddha, Gautama, Siddhartha had a movement back 3,000 years and whatever. And now he's come back 3,000 years later, and here he is. And he basically states in Hymn of Asia, you know, this is me, I am Buddha reincarnated. And Scientologists and Sea Org members, and especially you, Terrio, you should kind of, you know, wonder, who are you supporting here? You're supporting a guy who, in print, you know, actually says that, look, I am Buddha coming back. I am Buddha reincarnated. That's what I am. You know, don't you think maybe you shouldn't be supporting this guy? I mean, it's not like it's something I made up or something that, you know, his son maybe said or whatever. No, this is something that he wrote in a book, and it's still being offered at the church. As far as I know, it's still there. Maybe they pulled it in the last year or two, I don't know, but as of a couple of years ago, it was there. And he wrote it for a bunch of Buddhists. I think it was a Buddhist convention in the 60s or something. I can't remember what he wrote it for, but he put that, you know, he gave it to them and saying, yeah, I am Buddha, you know, no one else finds this kind of strange, and all Scientologists, you know, they've all skimmed over it. They know this, and so you should maybe ask them about the Hymn of Asia next time. Okay, another subject I kind of wanted to talk about is the thing called PTSness. It's called potential trouble source, right? And what that basically means is that you're connected to a suppressive person, okay? And when you're connected to it, per Scientology, when you're connected to a suppressive person, you basically is the cause. And I'm not making this up, it's the cause of all illness and all accidents, everything. I mean, you get a cold, a flu, a sneeze, bump your head on something. You're PTS, you're connected to a suppressive person, okay? Now, Scientologists actually believe this. This is practiced all the time. Like when you get a cold or something and you end up in ISO, I remember on the ship, boom, you're PTS, it's your fault, you're connected to an evil suppressive person. And you know, when you're on the ship, where are you going to find a suppressive person? You know, it's a totally isolated environment, but people on the ship were getting sick, were getting colds and flus, just like anywhere else was getting colds and flus all the time. And one of the main things they do is called the PTSCS1, which is basically, very simply, a little simple interview that you get on the meter. It's not even auditing, it's just an interview. And all it does is it basically, they're trying to locate who the suppressive is, you know, and you're... It's about an hour thing. It takes about an hour, half hour, something like that. And you get this PTSCS1. And basically, at the end of it, you find out your SP, and all of a sudden, you miraculously feel better. Now, in the 10 years I was in, I was maybe sick, maybe 14 times, something like that, with the odd cold or the odd flu, or, you know, I did a lot of trade work and stuff like that, so I kind of, you know, I may have gotten hurt a couple times, I might have smashed my finger or something, you know, I had minor stuff. So every time that happened, I'd be rushed to this interview, and I'd get this interview. And every time, me and the person on the other side would just be baffled because we'd have nothing. There'd be no item, there'd be no suppressive person, there'd be nothing. I mean, I was around nothing but Scientologists from morning to night. So how could I be connected to a suppressive person? I mean, I could barely get a call to my mother, for God's sakes. And never mind, you know, okay, I'm connected to a Hitler type, you know. I don't know. And the thing was, it wasn't just me, because I started to talk with other people, and they would get into, you know, it's isolation, you know, because they want to spread the sickness around to the other PTSners. But, so, you know, what all these people would go through the same interview, and one of my ex-girlfriends was actually the person doing the interview. She was the SSO on the ship. And she used to go through tons and tons of them, doing it absolutely standardly. She was Golden Age Tech trained, the whole thing. And nothing. There was never an item. And even Jason Begay says it on his interview. He said, you know, of all the times, they've never found an item. They've never found a suppressive person. I mean, they blame everything on this. Every illness, every, you know, if you come down with cancer, oh, well, it was your fault. You have, you know, you were connected to a suppressive person and you allowed that to happen. So it's your fault, you know. And they'll try to solve the illness using this instead of getting proper medical treatment, which you've heard other people talk about. And that's what happens, you know, you just because you're connected to this thing. Okay, guys, so anyways, I think that's enough for now. I'll keep this, I still have tons more material. I've just scratched the surface in these first five or six videos. I'll keep more coming, and there's so far not a scratch, so I don't know what OSA or Scientology intelligence are doing, but, you know, so far I have nothing. So I think they're getting a little bit powerless. I think it's kind of the duck and cover method is basically what they're doing, and hopefully they think the whole thing will blow over. And well, it's not blowing over. We're going to continue every month to do you know, the big raids and the mini raids in between, which I'm going to keep going to, because they do more than any of them, because Scientologists can't prepare for it. They don't know what's coming. So it really messes up their plans, so it's good. So try to get to as many mini-raids as you can. I'll try to make some more stuff, give you guys some more information, more leads that you can follow up on. And feel free to post the stuff anywhere, or take bits and pieces of it, make your own video. I love being surprised when I find myself on these weird sites everywhere. Mark Bunker was nice enough to put me on his WOG blog. Thanks, Mark. You know, I'm honored to be on that site. Anyways, it's enough for now. Enjoy your protest.